Now in this week's Primetime Living, produced in partnership with the Maryland Department of Aging and its Maryland Access Point Service, we are joined in studio by Dr. Peter Gorman of the University of Maryland's Rehabilitation and Orthopedic Institute. Doctor, thank you for being with us.
My pleasure.
We want to focus on the rehabilitation that can be done after someone has a stroke. What are the challenges that somebody faces in that situation?
Well, a stroke can manifest itself in very myriad of ways. Often people think about a stroke as just being a motor loss, a loss of motor control, a weakness in one side of the body or the other. But it also can be a visual problem, problem with swallowing, a problem with balance, a problem with communication, a problem with thinking. So it's a myriad of problems that can occur when a person has a stroke.
What's the natural course of the impact of that? So somebody's life, if it is a first stroke, life has gone along fine. All of a sudden, mm-hmm. you have what you call a brain attack.
Yes.
And some degree of impairment results. How much can you recover towards where you were, and how long does that typically take?
Well, it really is varied one person versus another. It's very individualized. And depends on the severity of the stroke. In other words, how much of the brain has been affected by the loss of blood flow to the brain. And it depends also on the person's general health, whether there are other coexisting illnesses that make it difficult to recover, say, for instance, diabetes, high blood pressure, other problems such as that. The general recovery is over days, weeks, and months.
Is there a point of diminishing returns when you get to 6 months or a year out? No matter how much intensive therapy you do, do you see fewer results?
Well, I think that the older ideas were that indeed there was some type of plateau at about 6 months. But I think thinking has now changed, that the idea of rehabilitation at 6 months, at 9 months, at a year, and at forever throughout the rest of the remaining person's life is really important to maintain health. So there is more thinking nowadays in the medical community, in the neurologic community, that stroke rehabilitation is a lifelong endeavor.
What's the role of technology now in stroke rehabilitation?
Sure. Well, we now have certain robotic devices that can aid a person with stroke rehabilitation and assist physical therapists and occupational therapists, for instance, in improving the mobility of arms and legs. These robotic devices, some of them are mounted on a desk, some of them are available for mobility during ambulation or walking. So there are various things coming to market, coming into the clinics that are available for these patients. They're not a panacea, but they do help.
Let me remind our viewers, if you have a question about stroke rehabilitation, you can give us a call. We'll have the number up on the screen. You could also tweet your questions. The Twitter address is at MPT News. Talk a little about the mental side of this. So on my previous analogy where somebody's life is going along fine and they hit this horrible speed bump,
yes.
It's not just a physical problem.
No, clearly it's not. And it depends a little bit on where in the brain the stroke has occurred. For instance, in most people, the left side of the brain is where our language centers are. So indeed, if the stroke has affected that part of the brain, the ability to communicate, whether to understand verbal or written language or to express verbal or written language, can be severely affected. In people who have strokes on the other side of the brain, their spatial capabilities may be impaired. And in either condition, there can be cognitive deficits, especially if one has had multiple strokes over their lives.
I should have asked that differently. I was thinking psychological as opposed to
sure.
mental. But say someone's mental functioning is not severely affected, but they have some physical deficits. There's a psychological impact of that.
This is true, and there is an increased incidence of depression in people with stroke, people who have had a stroke. It's a reactive depression. In other words, it occurs because of the fact that they have lost, they have changed, their body image has indeed changed, their abilities to get around the world has changed, and their capabilities to interact with family and friends has changed. But it also, there may be some biological and chemical changes that occur in the brain with a stroke that occur that make it more likely for these people to be depressed.
We're seeing some physical therapy being done. Is the psychological side something that you focus on at the same time?
Sure. I think we in the inpatient rehabilitation setting, which is indeed the setting that best helps people recover, it's a multidisciplinary program. Physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy, cognitive therapy, recreation therapy, physician help to prevent a secondary stroke, nursing help to help with mobility and bowel and bladder functions. These all come together in the inpatient rehabilitation setting to affect the best outcome, we believe, in stroke rehabilitation.
Let's grab a phone call. Baltimore City, this is Tania. Tania, thank you for the call. Go ahead.
Hello, yes. I was just wondering, is it possible to have a stroke or a mini stroke without any, medical evidence? Because a few years back, I had a incident where my left side started getting weakness, but with the CAT scans and everything that was proven, it was no evidence. Is there any way that it's possible that I might have had a mini stroke? I've been having problems with one side of my body. I've been had memory loss and everything. Is it possible that I might have had a mini stroke?
Thank you for the call. Best of luck, and we'll get you an answer on the air.
Yes, it is certainly possible that a very, very small stroke that may not be easily detectable by a CAT scan or an MRI may cause significant impairment in a person, because there is certain, for lack of a better term, critical real estate in the brain that if affected by lack of blood flow could really cause significant deficits. Small vessel strokes can do that.
Prince George's County, this is Myra. Myra, thank you for calling. Go ahead.
Yes, thank you. About 4 years ago, I was getting ready to go to work, and I had something that was like a little stroke, because my mother and father and my grandfather have all had strokes. And then later, a couple of days later, I had the same symptoms mm-hmm. as I was leaving work. And I ended up having to go to the hospital at Anne Arundel. And they said I had two, and there's a name for it, TI something.
TIAs?
Right. They said I had two of them, and it was like a warning.
Yes.
So I was on high blood pressure, Prozac, and all this medicine, statin. And I myself just took myself off of everything, and I haven't had that again. But I'm just wondering, should I keep in touch with a cardiologist, or I haven't had anything like that since then. Thank you.
Myra, we'll get you the answer on the air. Thank you for the phone call.
Well, yes, what she is talking about is a TIA, or transient or temporary ischemic lack of blood flow attack, TIA. These are episodes where the brain loses its blood flow to certain small areas temporarily, less than 24 hours, and then can recover. So it's suggestive that there is some blood flow problem in a given area of the brain. It is a serious warning sign, and I do think that those things should be treated seriously. So this individual and people like her should maintain a good relationship with a primary care physician so that blood pressure, diabetes, smoking cessation can occur to reduce the risk of having a TIA turn into a full-blown stroke.
Let's talk to Susan in Queen Anne's County. Susan, thank you for the call. Go ahead.
Yes, my husband had a stroke in October, and recently friends have been asking or telling me that they've heard about stem cell research being done for stroke victims. And I'm wondering if there is anything going on.
Susan, thank you. Best of luck.
I'm not specifically aware of a stem cell research program in the States. There are in China, in some other countries. There are some programs, I believe, that are being set up in the Californias. The idea of stem cells, let me just define that term. Stem cells are cells of the body that can morph or change into any particular type of cells. They are sort of potential cells that can change into, for instance, in the case of stroke, neurons or nerve cells. The hypothesis is that, well, these cells may be able to recover and repair damaged areas of the brain or the spinal cord. These things are clearly experimental at this time. I would refer people who are interested in this to a website, clinicaltrials.gov, which is a clearinghouse to all the trials for things like that. Clinicaltrials.gov is the United States clearinghouse for clinical trials, and if you search within that about stem cells and stroke, you might be able to find centers that might be doing this type of work.
Before we run out of time, we always want to say when we're on the subject of a stroke that you need to take the warning signs that some callers have talked about very seriously. If somebody develops certain symptoms, it's an emergency and you're in a hurry, what would you advise?
Sure. So we talk about stroke as being a brain attack, just like a heart attack. It is a medical emergency. If a person has weakness on one side of the body or the other, difficulty swallowing that comes on suddenly, change in vision that comes on suddenly, well, there may be a lack of blood flow to the brain. I do recommend these people go to an emergency room or call 911 to get acute care. There are ways nowadays that some, not everybody, but some people can receive clot buster medications to reduce the chance of a larger stroke. So that's really important.
Very good. Dr. Peter Gorman, Associate Professor of Neurology at the University of Maryland School of Medicine. Doctor, thank you for being here.
My pleasure.